good morning. It is so great to be at Columbus State Community College this morning in Ohio, my home state. And so I'm just so happy that you are here with me today and with Team Intel. Yes. To celebrate the semiconductor manufacturing education and research in collaboration with the National Science Foundation. And just in case you did not hear my name earlier, I am Pia Wilson Boddy, the president of the Intel Foundation, and I will be serving as your MC today. So, yay! But before we begin, I really want to take a moment to thank everyone that's joining us today, as well as those who have been passionate about STEM education and Ohio's workforce. They have made this moment possible, and that includes our governor of Ohio. That's you. Governor DeWine, thank you. And we have with us Lieutenant Jon Husted, thank you. The National Science Foundation, where are you? Doctor, there you are, there, National Science Foundation. And of course, our partners, our incredible partners at Jobs Ohio. Jobs Ohio, where are you? You're in the house, there you are. Columbus State Community College, making this day possible. Where are you? And of course, my colleagues who have traveled far, Intel, Team Intel. And I want to make certain that we acknowledge those joining us from our two-year and four-year public universities, our four-year independent universities, and Ohio Technical Centers. We are so, so glad members from the state legislature and local officials are here. If you are here, please stand. You make our work possible. So again, thank you for being here. Now let's get into it. So I'd like to introduce our host today, Dr. David Harrison, president of Columbus State Community College. Since becoming president, Dr. Harrison has served more than, get this, more than 45,000 students annually. And under Dr. Harrison's leadership, Columbus State has focused on improving student outcomes with an emphasis on equity. So at this time, I'd like to bring forward Dr. Harrison.
Thank you, Pia. Welcome home. Yes. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Columbus State Community College. We're so glad to host this historic event. This is a great room. We're so glad that you're here. I've been in the community college business a long time. And when I've seen major workforce announcements in other states, I've always been envious. I gotta admit, this feels good. I'll also admit that until a few months ago, I didn't know a lot about semiconductor manufacturing. But as I learned more about the industry and the talent that drives it, I kept thinking, these are our jobs. These are community college jobs. And Intel has been clear about that from the beginning. Highly skilled manufacturing technician roles will be the lifeblood of this work. And Ohio's community colleges stand ready to deliver. We're purpose-built for this moment. We've done it for the defense industry. We've done it for the automotive industry. and we're excited to do it for the semiconductor industry. Ohio's community colleges are committed to working together to develop a statewide talent ecosystem to help Intel and their supply chain thrive throughout the state of Ohio. Intel's deep commitment to diversity and equity is shared by Ohio's community colleges. Their focus on STEM readiness in underserved communities, opportunities for women in technology, and an explicit focus on veterans aligns perfectly with what we do every day. We're the most diverse institutions in every region of Ohio. We have strong internship, earn and learn, and apprenticeship programs with employers, many focused on advancing equity and expanding access to good jobs and high growth careers. Connecting Intel with these programs will be catalytic, leading to new ways of engaging students from all backgrounds. Another critical asset that will drive the success of this work is Ohio's network of great universities. Cutting-edge research will be critical to the long-term success of this industry. And we're blessed in our state to have top-tier universities to lead the way. At Columbus State, we're really lucky to work closely with President Christina Johnson and her great team at The Ohio State University. This strong partnership will grow even stronger as we work together in new ways. And I know similar relationships exist throughout Ohio, providing a workforce and research infrastructure that's second to none. We look forward to getting to work. One of our practices at Columbus State during the pandemic has been to start every meeting with gratitude, and I want to do that here. I want to thank our governor for making today possible. His steady leadership paved the way for the collaborative effort that got us to this point and will set the stage for great work ahead. Please join me in welcoming Governor Mike DeWine.
Well, President Harrison, thank you very, very much. We appreciate what you do, what Columbus State does every single day. Pia, thank you for being here. Appreciate it. You got the memo. It is St. Patrick's Day, so happy St. Patrick's Day to everyone. You know, when we first started talking with Intel, one of the things that they asked us about and we talked about, of course, was employees, people who would join them when they got here. And one of the things that I think they valued in Ohio was our great two-year university system, our four-year university system. And they made it very, very clear that they intended to work with our colleges, and with our universities, both the two-year and the four-year. The announcement today that you're going to hear and the discussion today really is the first step in that, and the first, at least the first public step. And this will continue. And it really is a win-win. It's a win for Intel because of the quality of employees that they're going to get, and it's a win for, obviously, the students. It's also, though, a win for our colleges and our universities. This type of relationship with an amazing company such as Intel will make a difference for these colleges and universities around the state. And you'll hear some more details about that in a moment. Lieutenant Governor and I and Fran just came from a breakfast that we held at the governor's residence for some members of the state legislature. And we talked about, as you can imagine, a lot of different things. But one thing we really talked about, and where there is clear, it doesn't matter whether you're Democrat, Republican, liberal, conservative, whatever, that there's just a real, I think, strong consensus in regard to. And that is that in Ohio, we need to really continue to invest in our people. My goal, Lieutenant Governor's goal, Ohio's goal every day is to make sure that every Ohioan, no matter where they live, no matter what zip code, no matter where they grew up, they have the ability to live up to their God-given potential. And the ticket to do that It's no secret. It is, in fact, education. And that's how we do what's right, which is to allow every Ohioan to live up to that potential, no matter what their background, no matter who their parents are. But it's also, candidly, a key, maybe the key, to the future of the state of Ohio. So this is a very, very happy day as we kind of really begin this relationship between Intel and our education's institutions in the state of Ohio. One of the fringe benefits we're getting by having a great company like Intel, a company that is focused on being good neighbors and focused on being part of the community, is they're going to be here, and they're going to be here a long, long, long time. Last night, kind of a very fun and a very important event for the Dayton community. Miami Valley is the first four. Fran and I were there to root on Wright State, and they won. It's a good thing. Very happy about that. But this is, it's also really a great tradition in Dayton, and it focuses on something that I know Intel cares very much about, because they made this very clear, and that's our veterans. They like to hire veterans. They care about our veterans, and they care about those who are in active duty as well. Last night, one of the things that occurred is Army Chief of Staff was here, General Brown, and swore in some new members of the Air Force. And Keyvan and the team were right there. They also put a little money in as well. They became one of the sponsors of a program that is just a great program. And that is every year what happens in the Dayton community is that a number of companies buy tickets to be given to our active duty families who are in the military. And to some of our veterans. And so, Keyvan, we appreciate that very, very much. We appreciate your leadership. We're so happy to have you as members of the community, and we appreciate that very much. So a happy day today, one more step forward, I'll turn it back to you and or whoever I hand it off to. Keyvan, am I introducing you? Well, come on. All right, well. Well, Keyvan and the team, you know, Fran and I left after the first game, but I don't know if any of you watched it on TV, but the second game saw a double overtime. So I'm sorry we missed the double overtime and Notre Dame win, but, I knew I had to perform this morning and do a breakfast and a few things like that. So I thought it was a good idea to leave. So Keyvan, thank you for coming back, and we're delighted to have you and your Intel team here, and appreciate it so very, very much.
Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. All right. Hey, good morning, folks. Thank you, Governor DeWine. Good morning, everyone. What an honor to be here again. And I have the pleasure of leading Intel's global manufacturing and supply chain and operations, and I'm excited again to be back here in Ohio. That's a short way of saying my neck is on the line to make sure this project goes really, really, really well. So, but as we're here to really celebrate this amazing journey ahead of us, Intel is a global company, and I want to take a step back and again, recognize the people of Ukraine that are going through this very, very difficult situation. So we as a company, with our operation all around the world, we support, as we are bringing on these amazing capabilities, of course, we want to make sure that the folks in Ukraine and they are in our heart as we are going through this very, very difficult situation for them. All right, so with that, let's reflect back on what we said back in January. When Pat Gelsinger, our CEO of Intel, and myself, we were here in this great state, and we announced a $20 billion investment just for the first phase of this project. And this is the largest expansion of a mega site in Intel's last 40 years history. It's a big bet that we're making. And this is where I also want to report that project is on track. In fact, we are a little bit ahead of schedule, which is I said end of the year. I still say end of the year, but nevertheless, things are looking good so far. And I'm also very grateful to the team, the local team here, especially in partnership with our friends in Jobs, Ohio, who are just every step of the way with us. They're actually applying also a little bit of a healthy tension, so thank you. Please keep that going. Every week, we are meeting in a task force mode to make sure all the plans are coming in place. All right. The other thing I also want to say is, why are we doing this, right? And it really comes down to, if you believe that the world is going more and more on data, if you think that's going to continue to grow, the heart and the brains of what that really enables that is semiconductors, is all these chips, right? That's the backbone of basically the data. And more and more, the economies around the world are absolutely depending on this data. Some refer it as new oil, right? And it's a matter of national security. It's something that, if you look back the last 2 years, what is the one big lesson learned, right? The global supply chain and that resiliency is more critical than ever before. When the world depends on this unique capability to power the world of data, and it's all concentrated in 80% of it in one region of the world, that's not okay. For a global company like Intel that supports all the customers all around the world, right? Supports the people all around the world, right? That's not a good situation to be in. And it impacts people's lives. Those of you who are out there buying cars or appliances or TVs or anything that, you know, has any references to electronics, they're all delayed. It's impacting our lives, right? Why? Because of this very issue. So what we're doing and what we want to make sure the world does not come to stand still is to make sure that we are solving that problem, right, together. And to reach these goals, it's going to need to come down to many, many elements, but the most important and critical element is talent, right? And Intel's need for highly skilled talent can be felt, you know, in every element of our operations, all the way from, you know, workforce coming in with a couple years degree, supporting our operations in the factory, all the way to the, you know, bachelor's, master's, PhDs. So this is an operation that requires talent across the whole spectrum. And you'll hear a little bit more about that. But the good news is we're absolutely confident that we can build those capabilities, right? And we're well underway to build these two new fabs, right, that we have here. This is fabrications facility. But on top of that, we're also expanding globally, right? We announced two major expansions in Arizona. We have one going in New Mexico. Our research and development operations in Oregon, as well as yesterday, we just announced a big, huge expansion also in European Union with many, many countries participating, right? So we are going full steam ahead, and particularly here in Ohio. So over the years, Intel has pioneered successful partnership with educational institutions and community programs across the country. And however, I would say that even these highly successful programs already in place are not going to be enough to meet the needs of the talent. You know, we need tens and thousands of talent, highly skilled talents, right, to really come and enter this field in order to thrive it, and not just, you know, race to the third or fourth or fifth place. to be number one. And let's not forget, this technology that actually powers the world of data was innovated right here in the United States. So it's absolutely critical that we need to continue this pace of innovation moving forward. And as I said in January when we announced the new site, one of Intel's top reasons of choosing Ohio is access to this diverse workforce, strong educational institution and the foundation, and the supporting infrastructure, such as the governor mentioned, the veterans, and bringing on these highly skilled talent into our workforce. And we have been very, very successful to be utilizing veterans. So it's a whole spectrum of the type of talent that's going to be required to really run this world-class operation. Again, the goal is not to be second or third place. We want to be number one. And I see that. Yes, last night, you know, just see the, you know, the minds and heart of people in Ohio. It's all about winning, right? It's all about winning. That's what it's all about. Because it's a competitive world out there. And I know nobody here takes pride for the distance, huge distance between second place and first place. Now, I run a global operation. I have to be careful because everybody wins together. How about that? Since cameras are pointing at me, to my friends across the rest of the company and everywhere in the world who are watching me. There's no favorite child. All right. So, and supporting the needs of these growing semiconductor needs is going to require a strong ecosystem. It's going to require investment. It's going to require energy. And absolutely, Intel is committed and dedicated for the investment needed in the region. And we're going to continue that. It's a long haul. It's when we're talking with, you know, our governor and lieutenant governor, we said this is like marriage. It's going to be for a long, long time together. And, you know, once you are married, and we already got married in January, we are going to be in this together for a long time. And, you know, since our last announcement in January, what do you think is the first question I get? Why Ohio? You have many options. And I tell you, the answer, although we had thousands of, you know, variables we look at, I had hundreds of people look at this, it really comes down to three things, right? It's really around land, okay, your infrastructure, and most importantly is talent, right? And I say Ohio meets all of them, right, comparatively to everywhere else we looked at. So I'm absolutely convinced this has been the one of the best decisions, and the impact of it has been just so much more than what we ever thought, because as people saw this, they said, wow, this makes so much sense. How many of you watched the State of Union a couple weeks, 3 weeks ago, right? After President's remarks about, you know, of course, there were several topics of recognition. After Ukraine and Russia situation, this project, the president calling Ohio an Intel project, got the second most applause. The bipartisan support of this project is just felt, this is not just about Intel or Ohio, it's about what's enabling the whole nation and the whole, everybody around the world. And others, including Europe, are following the lead here. So we should all be proud. We have a big responsibility on our shoulder to carry this commitment all the way through. And as I mentioned, today is about announcement of our talent strategy. I sincerely appreciate all of you who are going to be our partner in this journey, are here to, you know, we as a team, we all have a job to do. And I know you are all taking your role very, very seriously. And to share a little bit more with that, I'm going to introduce my good friend, Christy. She is our executive vice president in charge of our global, I would say, people programs, talent, diversity, our chief people's officer, Christy. Please come up there and tell us more.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, Keyvan. And so I just want to say first, it's great to be back in Ohio.
And it is my honor to serve as Intel's Chief People Officer, especially at this incredible inflection point. And we often talk about in the company, as former Intel Chairman Andy Bryant once said, the ingredient we start with is sand, and everything else is value added by people. And this couldn't be truer, more true than today. So if there's one thing we've learned in our 53-year history, is that we have to invest in our people today if we want to invent the technologies that we need for the future. And so Intel, you heard from Keyvan about our commitment to the operations. I want to talk today about our commitment to America's workforce with technology skills needed now and into the future. So we are building a comprehensive attraction and engagement plan to support hiring the talent here in Ohio, which will include large-scale recruiting and hiring events. You may have heard, but just to recap, beyond the 7,000 construction jobs that are going to be required for this project, we're also going to hire 3,000 Intel employees to work in the two fabs that we're building right now. And these full-time positions are going to span roles that require a two-year associate degree, all the way through to roles that may require a PhD, so that we can test the limits of science and continue to improve and innovate the products that we make. Moreover, our plan includes exploration of STEM development programs at the local and the regional and the national level so that we can make sure that we are filling the pipeline that we need with education. And this will also include a manufacturing technician certification effort. For us, we believe that investing in education is necessary to ensure that we have the right talent here to help the United States regain leadership in semiconductor manufacturing. And as you heard from Keyvan, it's a technology and a capability we invented here. So we want to regain that number one position. So today, I'm very proud to be able to share the details of what we're announcing today, which is a $100 million investment that Intel is making to establish semiconductor manufacturing education and research collaborations with universities, community colleges, and technical educators across the United States. This is going to address immediate semiconductor manufacturing technical challenges and workforce shortages. We know a lot about that, right? So many of us in this room are in the business of trying to accelerate closing those gaps. In addition to Intel's $100 million investment, the United States National Science Foundation is going to fund an additional $50 million for national opportunities. So in total, we're talking about $150 million that are going to be made available for semiconductor manufacturing education and research. So let me break it down, because I'm sure you have a lot of questions. So the first $50 million will stay here in Ohio's higher education institutions. Part of that will go to establishing Intel's semiconductor education and research program for Ohio to fund a collaborative multi-institution research program that's going to emphasize real-world experience and innovating in semiconductor fabrication. So that's the first $50 million. The second $50 million from Intel is going to support educators and researchers nationwide in developing curriculum at two-year and four-year universities, also inclusive of minority-serving education institutions, so that we can advance education and research in semiconductor design and manufacturing. Very, very important that we do that as well. And then the third $50 million will be a match from the National Science Foundation in funding opportunities for researchers and educators across the nation. The initiatives will increase access to opportunities that will help remove institutional barriers to state-of-the-art STEM education models. And we know this is so important. We know, and there's all kinds of empirical evidence about the value of a STEM education and STEM jobs and how they're just offer so much greater economic advantage over time. And we want to help fuel that for the students here in the state and those that we need across the country. So our goal is to bring these programs and opportunities to a variety of 2- and 4-year colleges and universities and technical programs, because it's critical that we expand and diversify STEM education. And so we believe these combined investments are going to provide the resources that are needed to create new curriculum for associate and undergraduate degrees, for certifications, for faculty training, for reskilling and upskilling the workforce for today and for the future and more. And so, in closing, at Intel, our purpose is to create life-changing technology that improves the lives of every person on the planet. That's actually our corporate mission. And so we will only be able to fulfill our purpose by closing the technology skill gap and ensuring that we create a robust pipeline of talented and diverse technologists who can join us and work with us to continue to grow and innovate. So thank you so much for your time today. And I'm going to turn it back to Pia, who's going to bring us forward to the next part of the program. Thank you, Pia.
So thank you, Christy. As you all know, you educators and academic partners, we continue, and you continue, to be the heartbeat of these new programs that Christy talked about, from developing curriculum to implementing the opportunities for students in the classroom. Educators across the nation will partner closely as we prepare our American workforce with the technology skills now and into the future. So we have a brief video message where you'll hear from academic partners in Arizona, Oregon, and New Mexico. So turn your attention to the video.
Central New Mexico Community College partners with Intel in a variety of ways. We work with Intel's experts combined with our faculty and certainly with our incredibly diverse and dynamic students to help produce the workforce that Intel needs and to help grow our local economy.
Maricopa has had a long-standing partnership with Intel. Most recently, we've partnered with Intel to create the world's first artificial intelligence certificate and associate's degree program. And beginning in May, we will have our first cohort of students that in just under 2 weeks training, they will be able to enter into the Intel plant and begin as a semiconductor technician.
The partnership with Intel and PCC has been successful because over the years we have, in partnership, helped to create programming and strategies for STEM outreach and community engagement for underserved and marginalized communities throughout Washington County. And this has really helped to address the region's digital divide and opportunity divide as well.
Our partnership with Intel has provided an opportunity for our students to have access to cutting-edge technology and cutting-edge curriculum so that when they enter the job day one, they are fully prepared to be productive employees for the organization.
You know, I think that CNIM's partnership with Intel has been successful because of our shared values. We value innovation, we value quality, we value diversity, and working with very different types of people on really challenging, complex problems. And we do that with integrity. So I think our partnership has been successful, certainly because of our values, but also because of the hopes and dreams that we have for our community, and frankly, even broader for our world.
Our partnership with Intel has had a tremendous impact on our individual students and the communities they come from, by providing a career pathway to living wage job, equitable prosperity, economic mobility. And these partnerships in turn have helped entire families to move up. And this has a ripple effect across generations.
The more companies that we can get to do what Intel is doing for us, I think the better off we're all gonna be, and we'll just have a greater workforce in general.
I couldn't be more excited for our students to be exposed to what Intel can bring to them and really the solutions that together through that partnership that can be found.
We've greatly appreciated this partnership with Intel and look forward to many more years of strategic, effective partnering. And we really are interested and look forward to expanding those partnerships and helping Intel, our students, and our region to thrive.
Great, thank you again. I continue to be so honored to work with these dedicated educators and academic partners. Next up, I'm happy to introduce you to a dear colleague of mine. Gabriella Cruz Thompson, Director of the University Research Collaboration in Intel Labs. Gabby.
Thank you, Pia. And I am here just for a few seconds. I will introduce our next speaker, and then after the break, I'll be here answering your questions. So I will probably speak a lot more later, but right now I am very honored to introduce to all of you someone that I've been working with for many years now, Dr. Erwin Gianchandani. He is now the assistant director of the new directorate at NSF. Did you hear about this news? It was news yesterday, and this is his first public appearance. So thank you, Erwin, for joining us, and the floor is yours.
So much. All right, so good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Oh, come on, we can do better than that. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
There we go. All right, so my name is Erwin Gianchandani, and I serve as the Assistant Director at the National Science Foundation for Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships. And on behalf of our director, Dr. Sethuraman Panchanathan, and the rest of the NSF team, it is my distinct pleasure to be with you this morning, a day after our announcement, and to share in this historic announcement. This is a historic announcement for the state of Ohio, and it's a historic announcement for our nation as well. Now, for those of you who may not know us, the National Science Foundation is a nearly $9 billion independent federal agency. Our mission is to advance all fields of scientific discovery, technological innovation, and education. And we do this through grants to universities, to community colleges like Columbus State, to nonprofits, and to small businesses, grants that support researchers, educators, practitioners, and students in advancing discovery and innovation all across our country. And we do this specifically to ensure the U.S. remains the world leader when it comes to key economic sectors, whether it's artificial intelligence, next generation wireless, biotechnology, or sustainable materials. So let's take artificial intelligence for example. The AI revolution that we're witnessing today, the one that's dependent upon these semiconductors, it traces its roots to investments by NSF in the 1980s and the 1990s. So for example, when you go home tonight and your favorite streaming service, I won't say which one, but your favorite streaming service recommends the next show that you should watch based on what you watched last night, that is fueled by NSF-funded research on a technique called collaborative filtering that goes back nearly three decades. But as Gabby said, we are also not resting on our laurels. Just yesterday, we proudly launched a new unit called the Directorate for Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships, or TIP, at NSF. This new directorate is NSF's first in 32 years, and it builds upon the agency's commitment over seven decades to serve as a beacon of U.S. innovation. Our goal with TIP is to support the technologies that address our foremost societal and economic challenges, that accelerate the translation of research results from the lab to practical outcomes that impact market and society, and to partner in a way that taps into the talent pool that exists across this great land. And Keyvan mentioned this, but we look forward to Congress passing the Bipartisan Innovation Act, which we believe will be key to fully realizing the goals of this new directorate. So now let me spend a moment on today's announcement here in Columbus. You've heard Keyvan and others talk about the importance of US leadership in semiconductors. Without the chips that power the smartphone that I can see a few of you glancing at right now, the car that got you here, the refrigerator that cooled your breakfast, or even the coffee maker that made the coffee for you this morning. Without the semiconductor chips powering those devices, we would be living in a very different world. And we wouldn't be able to talk about the advances that we're witnessing in AI, in biotechnology, in quantum computing, and in a whole host of other areas. And so that's why we at NSF are thrilled to be joining forces with our friends at Intel to be able to accelerate advances in semiconductors that power our lives and our futures. We are building with Intel, we are building on a nearly decade-long relationship with Intel to support the frontiers of computing and electronics. And over the next decade, as you've heard, NSF and Intel will jointly invest $100 million to support the research at America's colleges and universities that will drive future semiconductor design and manufacturing. The work that we fund will find its way into the chip-making facilities that will soon be rising not far from here, to the manufacturing floors there, to the tiny devices that are departing those facilities, and eventually to the products that are in our homes and offices that we consume on a daily basis. But not only that, we at NSF are deeply, deeply committed to addressing the immediate semiconductor workforce shortages that exist here in Ohio and throughout our country. And this is where a place like Columbus State is so critical in our minds. We consider our community colleges and our trade schools all across this country to be our nation's vast and untapped treasure trove. It is high time, in our view, for us to harness the talent at these institutions and to benefit from the diversity that they offer. And that is why our partnership with Intel specifically emphasizes training in community colleges, in technical and trade schools, in minority-serving institutions, together with all of higher education, to be able to ensure that we are training for all kinds of jobs of the future: technicians, practitioners, researchers, teachers, and entrepreneurs. We have to explore new ways to design instructional material that leverages the latest research coming out of our labs, to professionally develop faculty, and to encourage other professionals to transfer and integrate into the semiconductor manufacturing fields. And that is why we are excited today to bring the public and private sectors together, to bring leading capability and capacity in semiconductor design and manufacturing back to the United States. And so on behalf of my colleagues at NSF, again, we look forward to working with Intel, with all of you, and throughout the country to develop new technologies and products that improve our way of life, that grow our economy and create new jobs, and that strengthen and sustain US competitiveness for decades to come. Thank you.
And we're excited too. Very excited. So thank you. At this time, I'm going to bring up Lieutenant Governor Jon Husted for a few remarks. Did I get it right?
All right, Keyvan, you got my competitive juices flowing. You talked about basketball, made me think of teamwork. I see the Chancellor chuckling over here. Look, we're about ready to tip off for March Madness, where the productivity in businesses around the country falls off as they go and watch their brackets and watch the games. But when you think about it, it is teamwork that makes it all happen. Those who collaborate best are the ones that win. The teams that got into this tournament today didn't get there because they had five players out on the court doing their own thing. They got there because they worked together. And when you think about what's we're doing right here, it's about how we're working together. It's about how business has to work with the administration and the Congress and the legislature. It's about how our high schools and career centers and our community colleges and our universities, how we all collaborate on a common mission of delivering a winning team. And that's exactly what we intend to do in Ohio. That's what we have been doing in Ohio. That's why you decided to call us home, right? It does take teamwork. And what I would like to do today is to speak more directly to the people of the state of Ohio about how you can use the great resources that are being provided for you to take advantage of the wonderful opportunity that is coming our way as a state. And I remember, this effort with STEM started a long time ago, didn't it, Chancellor? I remember when I was Speaker of the House and Chancellor Gardner was in the Ohio Senate, and we started talking in 2007 about creating a STEM learning network in Ohio. We had people look at us like we had three eyes, like, what's STEM? What is that? And since that time, Ohio has built the capacity in our educational institutions to be the state that you chose to call home to the largest semiconductor production facility on the planet. What we have for the people of the state of Ohio and the students to take advantage of right now is a STEM learning network that has 80 STEM designated schools, 7 independent STEM schools, and dozens of STEM-focused career plans, programs. This is all available at your local high school or through one of the institutions in your community. We have the Choose Ohio First Scholarship, a STEM scholarship that was created back in 2007. Since its inception, we have invested $177 million in the program, and under this administration, thanks to Governor DeWine and the legislature, another $49 million is available over the next few years for scholarship money for Ohio high school graduates to take advantage of that program in our colleges and universities. High school students, today, you have a College Credit Plus program that's available for you to earn college credits while you're in high school. Over the last 6 years alone, it has saved Ohio students, and this is a shocking number, for Ohio high school students that have taken advantage of this program, it saved them $883 million in college tuition costs. And to date, just in that period of time, it's awarded to high school students. They were in high school, but they got 3,531 associate's degrees, over 1,200 certificates, and even one student earned a bachelor's degree while still in high school, all free of charge, thanks to the generosity of the people of Ohio. And we're focused on also enhancing more in-demand tech credentials in our state through our high schools. We're offering more and more in-demand credentials all the time, and we're actually paying incentives to high schools to graduate more students. So at your local career center, at your local high school, these programs are available with college credits and credentials so that you can leave high school and go to work at Intel. And we have more than 54 school districts that are participating in this innovative program and growing. And for adults, you may say, okay, that's great, Lieutenant Governor, but I'm already out of school. I'm in the workforce. I have a job and a life to support. We have services for you too through TechCred. This is where an employer identifies an employee. They identify the in-demand technical skill that they want them to have, and they simply enroll, and we will pay up to $2,000 for them to earn a credential. And just since the beginning of this administration, we have awarded over $40 million to more than 1,700 employers that has led to the opportunity to earn 36,703 in-demand tech credentials in Ohio for people who are already in the workforce. If you want it, it's there. It's there for you. And through the IMAP partner program, even if you're not working with an employer, we can enroll you and help you earn an in-demand tech credential, and we will pay up to $3,000 of the cost of you earning that credential, which covers the vast majority of all the credentials that are out there. Thank you, General Assembly, for your continued support of that. And this is not even mentioning the innovation districts that we created in the last couple of years. We created three innovation districts, started in Cincinnati, created one in Cleveland, we have one in Columbus, where our private sector and our public sector institutions are collaborating with the goal of tripling the number of STEM graduates in the state of Ohio over the next 10 years. $450 million have been invested for research and STEM graduates. Ohio is leading the way. And by the way, you cannot get to these goals that we have through Choose Ohio First or through the innovation districts with traditional students. We have to find a way to make STEM education exciting and interesting and valuable for people who maybe didn't think that they were capable of it. And believe me, you are. There's somebody I'm sure that's listening to this and goes, man, but that's great, STEM, but that's beyond me. No, it's not. You're selling yourself short if you think that. There is a pathway to a STEM education for everyone, if that's what they want to choose. And while we focused on these amazing jobs that Intel is creating and other businesses in our state in the tech sector, Keyvan, we have quite a construction project to do, don't we? 7,000 construction jobs, right? Ohio is one of the leading states in the country for apprenticeships. One of the leading states in the country for apprenticeships. Heavy machine operators, HVAC technicians, electricians, engineers, plumbers, welders, mechanics, and all trade skills. We're gonna need them all. These are great careers. And by the way, it's fun to drive a bulldozer. It really is. It's a cool thing to do. And these are all available for the people of the state of Ohio. We have 183 occupations that are apprenticeships in our state. And it's an amazing thing because instead of paying to go to school, you actually earn and learn to develop your apprenticeship. So this is available to everybody. So as a navigator, know that your local high school, your local career center, your local community college, your university, they are there to help. The Ohio Means Jobs Network is there to help to make sure everyone in the state of Ohio who wants to take advantage of this amazing opportunity that's come our way has the chance to do it. It's one of the reasons that I love working on the things that Governor DeWine has given me the chance to do in Innovate Ohio and Workforce. We partner on this all the time, and we talk about what a great thing this is with Intel and the amazing opportunities that are coming to Ohio, because everybody wins. When you have great jobs, you have great career opportunities, you have educational choices for folks, you get a great career, you get to live your version of the American dream, businesses get the talent they need to succeed, and we know that while you have no favorites, Keyvan, that Ohio is going to be the place that you're going to talk about around the globe as the place that does it right. And we look forward to this great partnership with you as we go forward. Thank you very much.
I couldn't agree with you more, Lieutenant Governor. I just really want to thank everyone today who spoke about and shared the details of our $100 million investment. Do I need to say that again? $100 million investment over the next decade, really to establish our semiconductor manufacturing education and research collaborations with universities, community colleges, as well as technical educators across the U.S. So just in case you didn't hear Christy and Keyvan and the other speakers, let me just say it one more time. $50 million directly in Ohio Higher Education, I'm saying it slow, institutes, while partnering, of course, with our National Science Foundation on a combined $100 million funding initiative. I also want to give a final thank you to those who have tuned in live stream today. And if you'd like to learn more about today's news, please visit the newsroom at intel.com for the latest updates.